Welcome back to the Cyber Arena, ladies and gentlemen. It's time for game number 3. I guess I should use the correct numbering. We didn't actually play game 1, but it's now 1-1, Ben. It was quick. It was brutal. But now it's over, and it's up to Alliance to find an answer here as we head into game.
Was Loda drafting that game?
Unless something's changed. Mm-hmm. He's been the drafter, so I assume he was. I don't think it doesn't actually show you in game, right?
I think they changed it so that you can.
Okay. Maybe I'm
not. I wasn't paying attention. It doesn't show it on the overlay that they gave us.
Oh, yeah.
But it shows it on.
We'll check this game. I don't think they're going to switch drafters in the middle of the series.
They could. I mean, they've been very comfortable with S4 drafting.
Yeah, but that's like a. I don't know. I think that's something you do, like, if it doesn't work out at this event in the future.
I mean, it didn't work out in game 1.
It worked out the other 4 games. But, I mean, Na'Vi on their home turf, here live in Kiev, they have a way, you know. I'm eating my words already. I said I thought Alliance could win 3-0, but clearly I was wrong.
I said 3-0 or 3-1, but
I'll eat some crow. I'm happy to be wrong, though. It means we get a longer series.
Mm-hmm.
We'll get our first not 2-0 of the tournament, which actually is pretty surprising.
There's been so many stomps in this tournament, though. Like, out of the 9 games that we had thus far, one of them has been
one of them close. Was close.
And then one was, like, relatively close.
And then seven were stomps, and, like, 3 or 4 of those were outrageous stomps. Like, mm-hmm. Over in 10 minutes. It's definitely a very topsy-turvy patch in that regard. Do you think this game's going to be as quick?
I don't think so. I hope not.
You know, it's at TI3, we had the first game of Na'Vi Alliance was the same thing. It was like, it was that game where they drafted Visage, Venno, Vengeful Spirit, and they ran his aggressive tri-lane.
Oh, that was...
And that was just like a complete tail draft, like, and they just gave up in like 10 minutes. So this game slightly reminds me of that. Although technically, I guess it's game 2. We're already loading in. So heading into game 3, we talked a lot about Enchantress. We talked about maybe going for Bane over Rubick. Anything else? Maybe drafting more stuns or banning the heroes that are really good when you lack them. Timbersaw is something that's been slipping through.
Timbersaw, I think, is
something Alliance could be picking.
I think they should rate it more highly than they did before. They didn't for some reason that game, and even though yesterday they first picked it both games, mm-hmm. I don't really see a reason why they shouldn't pick it, considering Admiral Bulldog is much better on it. He'll get much more experience and have an impact even when he's under farm, unlike the Elder Titan. And they can also dump a mid in case they want to pick a Dragonite or something similar for Dendi, although I don't think they will.
I wouldn't mind seeing that S4 puck either that you had mentioned. So on that note, we're already inside the draft, and it's early. We're just a profit ban. I mean, I don't think we'll see anything too unusual. Maybe the Enchantress does get banned this time by Na'Vi, but that would be about it. Oh, no, so does Na'Vi have first pick again? Oh, no, they had second pick last game. That's right.
So for Alliance, who do you need to ban? You don't need to ban Wisp. That's for sure. But they didn't ban Enchantress yet.
Yeah.
But, they might not even...
I want to talk about this ban.
The Shadow Shaman?
Yeah, the Shadow Shaman ban...
Alliance is on Dire to this game.
Yeah. So it's interesting because they're showing a lot of respect for that strategy, making that ban. And because Alliance went for the Enchantress ban and the Visage, something that some other teams let through, Na'Vi gets Invoker. And Bulldog, he was on the pregame interview with Shiver, and he said that this hero is really strong. Loda said it's completely broken. Although, to be fair, he said, like, 15 heroes are completely broken.
He also doesn't utilize it. I think that S4 needs to...
S4 definitely is capable of playing Invoker.
Yeah, I'm not really sure why he doesn't. It seems like his kind of type of hero, too.
Yeah. I don't know. They go Timbersaw, though, and they get the Alk here as well. And the Timbersaw especially, it really keeps their options open. And like you said, flex picks are strong because it makes it hard to see.
These
how
are the
play.
Two, or I think these two are the two most flex picks. Too.
Most flexible heroes. They can both can go solo mid. Timbersaw can go off lane. Out can play support.
Maybe Nature's Prophet is more flexible.
Slightly more. Although we don't really see like that 4 position Prophet anymore. So, and we don't see him in woods actually. It's always into the lane, at least at the start. But it's going to be a Luna from Na'Vi. So they go for it early.
That is a very early Luna
and this
pick.
Time they don't have it with the Enchantress.
Yeah. So Alliance, they're definitely going to ban 2 supports here. I don't see why they wouldn't.
Yeah. Which supports do you ban?
I think they ban Chen as 1 because it synergizes nicely with Luna, and banning junglers from Puppy I think is really important for them.
Mm-hmm.
And then aside from that, it's what? Crystal Maiden, Venno, and Rubick and
Rubick, Bane. Yeah, I'd say probably Bane over Rubick.
They have Alchemist. Alchemist super long range stun.
True.
I don't think they need to worry too much about it. And Alliance, they don't have to draft. They don't have to draft the.
There's Chris. Did you mention Crystal Maiden?
Yeah.
Crystal Maiden definitely.
But Navi's taking that out surprisingly. But some people will say that Alchemist and Crystal Maiden are the strongest dual supports in the game right now.
Yeah, and as a pair, they work really nicely. Both have long range initiation. They can the Crystal Maiden can jungle. The Alc can transition into a semi carry if he needs to. Just a well rounded pair. But the Bane is going to be the ban from Alliance. So they get rid of a hero that they had trouble dealing with in game one. They already have one really good stun to deal with Grip here from the Alchemist pick. But still, Bane's frustrating to play against.
Alliance could also take Chen for themselves, too. I think that Invoker and Luna, similar to Storm and Luna, like we saw last game, they're very susceptible to ganks early, and Alliance just weren't able to put any pressure out with the Chen.
Part of that was, like, I guess you could say creep luck, because Puppy got Dark Troll, Warlord, and Centaur almost right away. And
right.
The first creep that
was the Hellbear
was a Hellbear Smasher. And then he got a Wildkin, so some of that came down to creep luck, but you know, a lot of it just came down to Alliance not really wanting to pressure mid that much.
Mm-hmm.
It is hard to kill the Storm when you have a DK there before he hits level 6. Like, how are you actually going to initiate on him?
That was a big problem.
And he got level 6 really late because of that first blood. So now we move into the next two bans. Alliance, one more support should come off here. Navi could be a support or it could be a farmer.
I think a Lifestealer ban wouldn't be too bad.
Pugna's out there. Don't know if he's going to be a choice for either of these teams. Alliance have run him. Mm-hmm. Navi's run him. But probably not going to see it with the Luna. Because they kind of fill that similar role. Normally the safe lane here that pushes a lot early on.
Yep. They're dipping into reserve time.
And we'll see the picks in a moment here, I imagine. Lich and Clockwork off the board. Lich, a hero that teams seem to have wildly variant opinions on.
They really do.
Some teams think the hero is like completely overrated and almost useless, and some teams think he's like completely broken or at least very strong.
I think he's situational.
Yeah.
I don't think he's worthy of a first.
Oh my god. It gets interesting, guys. It gets interesting now. We have a Wisp. Then they follow up with a Tusk. This is the aggressive Charlie we've seen from Alliance in the past that just completely face rolled their opposition.
VG
Gaming at EMS, that's right. And, it's a heal strat of sorts as a reply from Navi. They go Shadow Priest as well as Tree.
Yeah, all four of these heroes are fantastic at pushing, too.
Yeah. How are the lanes going to work for Navi? Can they deal with this aggressive tri-lane?
I think they could just turn Luna into Superman.
Superwoman. So sexist. Jeez. Yeah, this position will be important for them. And the one concern is that, you know, all Tree can do is really throw living armor. He can't actually harass. He can't really do anything in the lane.
Mm-hmm.
Generally, it seems like Tree's best when teams don't go aggressive and you can just farm and get levels and then help your solo mid win or help your off lane win.
Right. Curious to see who the solo mid pick is going to be for Alliance.
Could be the Timbersaw.
Yeah. Alliance just scared of one more offlaner.
Do you think like a Puck would be good this game?
For Alliance?
Yeah.
I think it's... I almost always think that Puck's good. Yeah. The only hero I don't really like him against is Shadow Fiend, because I don't think he can keep him down. And
Skywrath Mage is pretty tough as well.
Yeah. But no one picks Skywrath.
Yeah.
Dragon Knight, I think he's also like so-so against, just because he gets caught out too often in team fights. Alliance looking to ban out one other offlane. I'm trying to think of what offlane would work well with Na'Vi right now. Or potentially they could do like an aggressive try, because they might expect an aggressive try from Alliance.
Well, for now it's a Bristle Boss knocked off the board. This hero was an absolute terror in the G League finals earlier today. Literally unkillable. He had a heart. He had a Wisp backing him up. He's getting overcharged as well. And this would be an equally unkillable Bristleback in a different way, because he'd have the Shallow Grave, the heals, the armor increase, and living armor. So they don't want to give Navi an unkillable frontline tank. So in that sense, seems like a sensible ban.
So apparently Navi were expecting a solo mid, Alc, or a Timbersaw. or a solo mid Alk rather, and banned out the Chen. I don't think that Alliance would have taken the Chen at that point.
Yeah, I don't think so either. I mean, it could happen.
Oh, boy.
Oh, boy.
Oh, boy.
Behold the Horn of Magnus.
Did they get the last pick up? Yep, there it is, the TA. So
S4 Magnus, and then that was like an insta-pick onto the TA. Normally, if you're going for something like TA is your last pick, it's not like something you just slam down. You like think about it.
Is Dendi, will Dendi not be mid for once?
Are they going to try and get him 1v1 against Bulldog in like a side lane, do you think?
Yeah, I think so. I think Dendi will go safe lane. Havost, Puppy, and Kuro will go in the off lane, and then Fnatic with a solo mid.
Yeah. Well, that could... This is a really strong late game draft from Na'Vi. Luna, TA, and Invoker.
That's greedy.
That's very greedy. But
can they living armor all three of the heroes? Well, I don't think that Invoker will have that tough of a time in the safe lane. Unless he's against a Tri.
Yeah, the last time Alliance did this strat, I think they went aggressive Tri with the Tusk. I know they were crushing the lane early. Yeah, it was aggressive Tri lane on the Radiant side. But I don't know if they're going to get the matchup this time. We'll have to wait and see. But guys, it's time now for Game 3 of this Best of 5. Your Star Ladder Season 8 Grand Finals, over $135,000 will be handed out to the players at the conclusion of today's action. And we'll start here on the side of the Swedes, the Alliance. S4 going to be playing his signature hero as the Son of Magnus. He'll be taking the Magnus mid. We'll have EGM playing his sensational IO. Loda going to be handling the Alchemist, and Ake on the Tuskar. And last but not least, Mr. Bulldog himself on the safe lane Timbersaw.
And on the side of Na'Vi, we have Puppy on the support tree and protector. Avost on the Luna. Looks like he'll be farming in the safe lane. Fnatic looks like he has the solo mid TA build. Dendi might be the off lane invoker. No, actually he's headed mid. So where is Fnatic going to be? Fnatic's just going to be in the safe lane. And last but not least, we have Kuro on the Dazzle. So it looks like Alliance has actually not opted for the carry Tusk. It will be the support Tusk on Aki, and Loda will be on the Alchemist.
It was a farming Tusk last time, right?
Wasn't it? So I'm surprised that they went with that instead.
Tusk is not a bad support, but I feel like...
He's not a good carry.
Yeah. But he's an okay snowball, like semi-carry ganker. Mm-hmm. But you have to snowball.
Right.
Pun fully intended. No, not even a chuckle.
I've heard it too many times.
Oh, here they go. Straight on the bottom lane, and they're going to start with the ice shards on the Fnatic. He does manage to refract out the initial Alk stun, but they're just going to dive him. Do they go all the way? No. Good patience on the refraction.
He needed to walk in here a little bit earlier so that they could block his path in. And Templar Assassin, he only had Share Tanko, so he wouldn't have been able to eat his way in.
And for Fnatic, he was very patient there. Waited to refract until the stun was coming so he could dodge the biggest damage spell rather than using it just immediately, which is generally what you do when you see three heroes charge you. He's like, oh shit, I better use refraction. But he was very patient there. Well defended. And then I guess with that first blood attempt failing, now Na'Vi know the lanes. Can Alliance still find a kill here?
I'm surprised that Puppy didn't even use the armor for that. He hasn't even skilled it.
Yeah, maybe you just want to debate them a little more.
Yeah.
Either that or he's just very confident that Fnatic wasn't going to die.
Or maybe he wants to use Leech Seed for an early kill. Although I don't think they're going to be able to get an early kill in this lane.
Yeah, for the time being, both teams just trading. Na'Vi opted for dual lanes, and it's going to be a Luna Dazzle against the Timbersaw. Pretty good dual lane to harass the Timbersaw back.
Do we have in-game sounds?
I don't believe we do. Our producer, Roman, has gotten up for a moment, but we'll try and notify him when he comes back. I think we've had it some games, but not in our headsets, so I'm not actually sure if the stream's getting it or not. If they're not, I'm sure they're yelling right now. But, guys, we do apologize if there's no in-game sound. We'll try and get it sorted as soon as possible. But bottom lane. Alliance still tri-laning. They have hit matched at level 2, and Ake He has not opted for Snowball. He actually picks up the Frozen Sigil instead, which got buffed quite a bit in a recent pet.
You should definitely take at least one point in Frozen Sigil, I think, by four for sure. Some people will take it earlier, but it's a really good skill. And it also assists with tower diving. Loyota not going with a greedy build at all. No points in Greavel's Greed as of yet. In terms of the mid matchup, S4 versus Dendi looks fairly even. 11-5 on Invoker, 10-2 on the Magnus.
Yeah, and Dendi...
They're just smoke. Oh, wait, no. Nope, they're not smoke. They're just walking
just
mid.
Charging out of the bottom lane. Are they just going to abandon the offlane here, do you think? Looks like they're just going to head top. Can they make a go on Dendi? S4 does have a level 2 skewer, but that's a really difficult tower dive.
Yep, there's been a lane rotation, too. Kiro and Havos are now on bottom, and Fnatic is soloing Bulldog in the offlane.
So Na'Vi, they're going to end up with the Luna defensive tri-lane here against an offlane Alk. This is not an easy lane for Alk. I mean, sure, you could drop Acid Spray and just try and get a little CS that way, but if he ever gets caught out and the trees are ranged to Leech Seed, that's going to be an easy first blood.
Yep. Aki and Wisp, I'm not actually sure if they can kill Fnatic. I'm not really sure why they rotated top.
Just feeling like, I mean, I guess they're going to fall behind if they're not getting kills bottom. So that is one concern, I suppose.
Oh, they're rotating the whole entire lane now. Loda has TP top. And looking at the mid matchup, still looks like a relatively even early game. Kuro picks up Illusion Root on bottom. I'm trying to think about which team has more pressure to gank. And Alliance, if they play passively, Alchemist can super greet it up and Magnus will get his early blink. But Na'Vi, on the other hand, has the better late game with the Luna and the TA and the Invoker, the super greedy draft.
We, like, never see Greavel's Greed anymore, though, on Alchemist, even when it is rare, even on the rare times when it is played as a carry. I mean, eventually you get it, but we just have not seen anyone skilling even a single point before they've maxed both other skills. We'll see if Loda deviates from that here. And for Alliance, they are on the dire side. They do have a pretty good Roche lineup, so I mean, that's one way they can look to pull ahead in the mid game. But for now, they do need quite a bit before they can really take fights. The relocate for EGM, obviously getting level 6, 7, and the Blink Dagger for S4, so I would say they could be passive through a certain stage of the game, but yeah, you don't want to be like 30 minutes in and not forcing fights. Or even 20 minutes in, probably.
It's just a farm fest right now. I don't really expect any team to make a big move. Trudy, generally not the most aggressive hero. Magnus, fairly difficult to rotate when you don't have anything to set it up with, and he doesn't have arcane boots yet. They're not even close to coming, actually. He only has 400 gold on his person, and EO not going to be level 6 for quite some time. He is only level 3 now, so I don't think Alliance will be showing any aggression. They'll will play reactionary, though, in case they get dove. And yeah, Na'Vi more than content to farm it up with Luna and Invoker.
And the Treant as well, off in the jungle. So both teams just content to farm, confident in their mid game and their late game. We'll have to see if it pays off. The mid lane should be maybe a bit Invoker favored, but S4 is still farming very well. Is there anything that's surprising you about? You were surprised they abandoned the offlane. Do you think this is the worst play, or just weird that they would go aggressive and then give up on it so easily?
Well, it's weird that they're just not getting anything accomplished in their tri-lane. They didn't get anything accomplished. Well, they didn't get the first blood on bottom, and now Fnatic is not really hurting at all. His CS is like slow. Actually, they're going for a kill on Fnatic.
They're going for him now. They have Acid Spray here as well, but Living Armor keeps him in fighting shape. He dodges the stun with Refraction, hardly even taking damage. Can they bring him down? He's got a meld available soon. There's their Snowball. They're committing to this one, but he's got meld. He could look to try and run, and he's going to live. Alliance unable to secure the kill. Living Armor plus Refraction equals very freaking hard to kill.
Yeah, that's the tether actually broke. EGM didn't have money for boots there, so he couldn't keep up. I think maybe if they had the tether slow, they could have killed him again.
Unfortunate. But
yeah, very unfortunate.
It's where I guess they ideally want to get the Acid Spray down sooner and start removing the Refraction charges before they drop the stun, but
and Living Armor charges.
But that's easier said than done.
Living Armor plus Refraction.
Do you drop both with one damage instance? Or
I'm not sure.
Or do you like? Do
I'm
you
not, when I draft in you're, matchmaking, you're I never pick tree.
And you often I see you ban him in the second or third stage occasionally as well.
Screw tree. He's a good hero though. I just generally don't like his playstyle. I think the hero's fine as is. I don't think he's overpowered.
Yeah, he's just annoying to play against.
Yeah, he's super annoying.
And you play a lot of mid, and that's where he's the most annoying to play against.
really is.
It's literally a 2v1 mid, but for now it's a 1v1, unless you count the Forge Spirits, and Denny's using them pretty effectively. He'll scout the top rune. He'll rush the Force Staff here. Already has picked up Arena of Regen. S4, Arcane's online. He's still farming very well and keeping quite even with Dendi. Very slow start compared to game one. Neither team looking for those early kills, aside from Alliance's attempts in lane, but they have not been rotating around the map.
And Na'Vi de-wards this ward on top, so I don't think Alliance will be able to play aggressively at all for some time to come. S4, just playing safe in mid. Over under on when first blood's going to happen?
I'd say under 12 minutes.
12 minutes?
Once the
That's way too late of a line.
Way too late?
Yeah.
Wisp isn't level 6 yet.
Yeah, I would.
There's an Eclipse online, and that's actually a concern for Alliance. Does Havost have an early TP? He does. They have to be careful about a tower dive here. They might want to make a go on this TA, but that could really cost them if they go in. Plus, there's Sunstrike that can come through as well. It's very hard to go on this TA now, if you think about it.
Super hard.
There's so much backing up. Offlane TA, level 5 with 13 CS against a tri-lane. That's got to be like the best offlane
TA going for a kill
I've ever seen. And they're going now. Does Havost look to TP? He's actually busy chasing Admiral Bulldog through the jungle. No, now he TPs. Bunnik's still healthy. There's going to be an Eclipse here soon. This Wisp could be our first blood. It was actually Krogi TP'd in, not the Luna. Now a Sunstrike. Dendi nails it. Boom! Chakalaka brings down EGM.
Wisp with that zero armor. He took zero damage by the time he got out of the stun. That is ridiculous.
That's a 3 heroes and a lot of damage instances just unable to even scratch Funnik.
Yeah, they have the spirits, they have the acid spray too, but wow.
Hashtag ban tree. It seems like the pairing is really annoying to deal with.
It certainly seems that way. Might be a new age of the offlane TA.
Well, the offlane TA I'm okay with. The tree, please God no, spare me. Those were some truly awful games back in the dark ages when Tree first broke through to the competitive scene.
So Luna has also interestingly gone for... Oh, I thought he was about to cast
Eclipse. He actually was about to Eclipse. Loda, level 7. He is in ultimate form now. And S4 rotates down as well. Alliance, true to form, they just love to group up early. And, well, S4 is going to get Eclipsed. Oh, boy! Now top lane. They're going on Ake as well. They want to make this a 2-0. Can they kill him? He snowballs to the right, but there's really nowhere to run. Another Sunstrike, another kill! Sniper mode activated! Dendi's heating up. And so too is Na'Vi with him.
There's too many things to ban versus Na'Vi. They're utilizing these very interesting picks super effectively, and Alliance might actually get a tower and retaliation, but that's all they're going to get.
This is brutal, and they're going to find S4 as well. He TPs in mid all by his lonesome, but they're going to pursue him out. Can't believe he went for that. He tries to RP. Can't even do it. 4-0. These are some really uncharacteristic mistakes from S4. Like, he should not have TP'd to that tier 1. And the bottom dive...
He should not have gotten solo eclipsed.
Yeah, I think a little overconfident that he could surprise the host and pays for it. Na'Vi just in cruise control mode. And Dendi's going in. He wants Ake. He'll bring him down as well. Soloing one hero in Bulldog's face and not done yet. Drops the ice wall. Going deep. Dendi and Invoker, something to be feared, it seems. But this could be the turnaround item. Maybe. Just maybe. It is the Shadowblade for the Alk. We haven't seen much Shadowblade Alk lately. We haven't seen much one position Alk, but they need Loda to get some work done because the rest of the team is not pulling their weight right now.
the pressure is certainly on Lions. They cannot get in this game by farming their way back in. And S4's blink is going to be really delayed. Usually he gets it, I think, by the 15-minute mark at the latest, and this time it's probably going to be like 18 to 20 at a good pace.
He was farming really well before the two deaths. Now he's very far behind. And Dendi already over halfway to his Necro book and has double Forge Spirits.
He had his four-step.
He's level 11 at 13 minutes with no Midas.
That is,
and he might die now, which would be big. Yeah, looks like he's dead. Nice kill there for Alliance. They bring down Dendi, level 11. It does take 5 heroes to do it, so it's a big investment, but when he's level 11, that is, and has a kill streak going, that is completely worth it.
And S4 got the kill too, so that means his blink's going to come out even quicker than I expected.
He needed that. He really did. 1,200 gold all of a sudden, stacking the jungle. Should probably have it in the next 2-3 minutes. Something like that.
Yeah. If he doesn't die. And Wisp still not level 6 either. Tusk still not level 6. So even though Alliance have not had a lot of things going for them in the first 12-13 minutes of the game, it looks like they're pinging out Funic.
He's invis here. He might look to make a go in Loda. There's a Sunstrike available soon once Dendi respawns, but they won't go for it yet. And Funic's just going to TP out. Space created.
Space created indeed. But now, once they have the Blink Dagger, once they have the Relocate as well as the Walrus Punch, they should be able to get some kills because they're just really lacking on mobility right now. Na'Vi able to predict where they're going to go, just cast Living Armor, and that is usually a failed gank.
Can they get enough kills? Because Na'Vi basically have a tri-core, right? And you need to keep all three of these heroes down. It's actually that strategy that was really popular back in 2010. We saw Ehome running it. But that was before Smoke was in the game. It makes it a bit easier to set up ganks, as well as Wisp, for that matter. But here comes Alliance. They're a-hunting. But Luna's got BKB and has level 2 Eclipse in like one creep. Kuroki's going to get caught out, though. He's got no chance. Beautiful kill by Alliance, and they'll take it.
Not an important kill, but still a kill nonetheless, and they will be able to put a lot of pressure on this tower. S4, Blink Dagger status, 1,700 gold for him.
And with this tower, if they can take it mid, they'll have the Blink Dagger. Na'Vi pushing the bottom lane while S4 looks to defend for the time being, and in fact, they're split pushing with Funic up top. Has phase boots, has the Wraith Band, getting what he can. But the key items, the Blink Dagger, the level 6 on the Wisp, that's now obtained. A lot of the pieces fall into place here for the Alliance. And the Relocate's available. They can channel a stun, Shadow Blade, and TPN, and they're going to pop on top. They want to find Funic. Spirits are there. They dust just in time, right as the stun's about to connect. Now, Funic on the run. Timbersaw's there. They're going to bring Funic down, perhaps. His Acid Spray. Not quite enough yet, though. They need a little more damage here. He's going to meld. Can they bring him down with Chakram? Low. Dead. Bulldog does it. A beautiful kill. Alliance, give him 3 in a row after an 0-5 start.
Havos trying to kill Admiral Bulldog. He doesn't have enough mana for Timber Chain. Havos might be able to do it.
There's Eclipse here, but there's a Tether back out. Give him the move speed. Lucian Beam comes on EGM. Havos is not going to be able to find this kill, I don't think. They do have a Sunstrike, actually, if Dendi wants to invoke it. But not going to go for it.
That was a lot of time wasted, too. Space created.
It's the same story for Alliance in this game that it was in their previous four games, which was just where they excelled was their movement. And their movement early on was not that good, but it's been really good since those first 5 deaths.
Yep, Luna has her BKB now, so Havos very unlikely to be the relocate target. And Magnus has his blink, so S4, after those 2 really rough deaths for him, he's right back in the game.
And yeah, they're going to be stacking here. Loda can, with the Empower, can transition into a pretty farmed and fat Alchemist if he wants to. Goes for the early Vit booster. Do they go Roche here?
I don't think they have the damage for it. But
well, they do see Na'Vi pushing.
Oh, they have the Frozen
lane.
Sigil. That thing's Odin for Roche.
Oh, that works on Roche?
Yep.
I did not realize. And Na'Vi take a tier 1, but Alliance are going to look for a Roche. If that's all the trade is, it's a great trade for Alliance. But Na'Vi will threaten the tier 2 top.
Very fortuitous rune for S4.
Oh, they're already TPing. They want to defend this tower. They've got the relocate gank available. S4 with the blink RP. I imagine Navi's just going to back off once they see Roche fall and some heroes TP.
They don't know that S4 has blink, though.
Here they go. Potentially. Towers dropping
low. It's too dangerous.
Nope, they're not going to defend. Navi take two towers for Roche. Now, that's a pretty even trade. Maybe even slightly favoring. Well, not favoring Navi, but...
I would say it's favoring Navi.
That's a lot of gold.
Mm-hmm. But then again, Alliance is underhanded at this point, so a slightly favorable trade for Navi is about as good of a trade as they're going to get.
And it also depends what do they do with the Aegis. If they make plays with it, win a big teamfight, then it's worth it. If they just, you know, farm evenly from here, then Alliance comes out ahead in terms... Or Navi comes out ahead in terms of gold.
Loda got a casual Vit booster, which is a little bit surprising. He needs HP for Eclipse Burst, but he also needs armor against the Meld Burst from
and the
Luna.
Forge Spirits as well. And the Dazzle. It's actually a minus armor strat from Navi, something we didn't talk about. And they're getting a medallion on Puppy.
Not easy itemization for Loda this game.
How much minus armor do they have? Minus 8 from Refraction. The Dazzle can give you, in theory, like a ridiculous amount. Another minus 6 from the tree. Or 5, I guess. And then the Forge Spirits. I mean, this is like easily minus 20 plus armor if it all stacks up.
Loda doing the Ancient Stack with Empower. I think they also need a BKB too, or else he's just going to get rooted and die.
Yeah, Cold Snap. They have a lot of ways to kite him. Right. Cold Snap, the Tree Ult. And he's not their only damage, but he's their only physical damage. And with Luna already having a BKB, him being able to hit in these fights is going to matter. The gold... The experience, the experience actually has trickled back towards Alliance. The gold is going still Navi's way as they group up top again, but there's no tier 2 to take this time. And Alliance, I think realizing that Navi is all over their jungle, are going to back off a bit. And certainly now they've spotted out quite a few heroes rotating through. Pretty hard to deward ward over here.
And... Yeah, they were just taking control of the opponent's jungle right now. We see a smoke from Admiral Bulldog, S4, and Aki. They're looking to make things happen right now. Looks like Navi are grouped up in mid, but not close enough for RP just yet.
Yeah, they have 5 here with the Wisp Relocate if they want to go for it.
This is dangerous. I still don't know if they saw the blink on Mag.
Well, S4, he's going to make a jump soon, perhaps. Nope. Just going to shockwave. Okay.
Necro book preventing his blink too. They need to kill that book.
Yeah, a lot of ways to prevent the blink. You can just stick Forge Spirits on him as well. But Navi, now they've definitely seen it and may look to back off. No, they're not afraid. Should they be afraid?
They should be afraid.
They're fighting into RP and Aegis, so if this RP is big, it's going to be a bad fight for them.
So it looks like Alk with the casual Vit booster as well as the plate mail. So I think he'll be able to survive the Eclipse Burst. We haven't seen any Shallow Grave as of yet. He's also gone a very atypical build with a 1-2-4 build on Dazzle. Usually you see Max Poison Touch if you want to gank, which he really hasn't been doing. For defensive builds, Max Shadow Wave and Max Shadow Wave and Shallow Grave is best, but you don't really need the 1 point in Poison Touch. I don't really think it's that good of a value point.
Yeah, and I think the Grave of the two defensive abilities does scale the best, as we see Loda running and looking to channel a stun. I mean, you look at the range for Shallow Grave at level 1, and it's pretty bad. This is level 2, but 550, not even a range to your auto attack.
And the cooldown reduction is massive.
Yes. And it means if you have it maxed, you can stand really far back and get it off safely. But Alliance will just stubbornly hang on to mid while Navi also stubbornly continues to push and mount their assault. They're not really committing to anything much yet. Are they going to go here, or do they just want to keep Alliance bottled up for the duration of this Aegis?
I don't think it's going to last that long.
Yeah, they've got like 2 minutes left, I believe. Not a whole lot of time here.
S4 looking for an opportunity, but Navi not really giving it to them. They need vision in this area too, but there is no warden here from Alliance.
Out come a scouting set of ice shards, but won't connect on anybody. Now Loda forced to back off. He was almost in Sunstrike range, but pops the ult and almost instantaneously up to full HP. They'll deward a trap here as well as a Navi sentry. More shards coming out. Do Alliance jump here? They throw out a stun, lob it onto Havost. No commitment just yet. Patient play, both teams kind of feeling each other out for the time being. They'll start with a loosen beam on Loda, his ultimate gonna end.
They might fight now that Loda's ultimate
down. Force staff initiation, ult's down, but they do have a relocate, overcharges there. Not enough, but still puppies lurking. Radiant's top tower. They haven't spotted him though, no observer ward here for Alliance in their own jungle. And looks like the Aegis will expire uneventfully unless the Lions fight right now, which they may want to do. No. Just S4 heading bottom.
At this point, they may want to get an early gem.
Are they just going to use an RP here on Funfunic?
I still think
Plague
it's a really
RP is available. RP is going to connect now. In come the spirits, and they will bring him down. Another nice kill for Alliance. That's four in a row, unanswered by Na'Vi.
Yeah, he did not survive. I thought he was going to be more tanky considering what we saw in the early game, but yeah, he just got blown up.
And Alliance starting to just use the strength of their lineup, which is finding these pickoffs here and there from the relocate ganks to the blink RPs into a relocate. Also the Shadowblade out strong for that as well. Their lineup, maybe not the best late game, but in terms of pure damage output, but in terms of just setting up easy kills, very strong at that and using it to its fullest extent.
Na'Vi also deviated from their early aggression into greed strat because they spent way too much time in middle. Trying to push into RP is just so extremely difficult. And the Aegis on Lota has expired. So now Na'Vi trying to make another move.
There's a glyph available here though, but they know RP's down. Not a bad time to fight. They'll go for the Blink Skewer, but Havos, he's going to turn around with an Eclipse. Lota will fall. Locked down by the Eclipse. Nicely done from Na'Vi. And the tower as well. Now a Deafening Blast connects a Bulldog. They want a secondary kill here. They catch a mid-timber chain. They slice him up. Bulldog falls as well. And all of a sudden, Na'Vi have some momentum here. Maybe not enough to break base. Maybe enough to damage this tower, though. In fact, they force out a buyback on Lota. That's an Assault Caress deferred.
That's going to dissuade S4 from casting RPs on solo heroes, because that was a fairly important hero too on the TA, but Na'Vi got a lot more out of that than Alliance did. Na'Vi sacrificed one hero kill for two hero kills and a buyback and a tower. So that's definitely worth it. And they're one of the better teams about taking advantage of that relatively short cooldown for that powerful an ultimate, less than 2 minutes.
I guess one issue here for Alliance is that they often, whether they have Magnus or not, they usually have heroes that have some ability to split push and spread the map, like the Prophet for Bulldog. When you don't have that ability to apply pressure and push the lanes, then when you use RP,
oh, S4 might get caught out here.
It's a fight.
Blink not up yet?
No, just Skewers down. But was trying to do a bit of dewarding. They do drop the sentry, and he will get out safely. When they're not split pushing, if they use RP on a single hero, then Na'Vi can force them to fight. And they're just not that great at split pushing.
Yep. Alliance just huddling around the Roshan pit, waiting for it to respawn. It is going to be a relatively short respawn, around 45 seconds time. Na'Vi can take a fight inside of there with the Treant Overgrowth, which we actually haven't seen yet this game. There is a mech completed on Puppy 2, and I don't believe there is one completed yet on the side of Alliance. So Na'Vi definitely stronger right now if they want to force a five-man engagement around the pit.
Overgrowth's really strong, actually, and I think a bit underrated. Sure, it does no damage, but if you have a high damage cast backing the tree up, I mean, this is a melee carry in the Alchemist, and potentially he does nothing in a fight if the Overgrowth's at the right time.
Oh, here's a smoke. Roshan just respawned. Neither team knows yet.
No Sunstrike yet. They haven't actually scouted the pit, but they're marching towards it. Charging forward. Havost is going to be the one on the front lines here. 2,400 gold in the bank. Could buy back. If they win this fight, he'll have his Manta. And Na'Vi will wrap around. They head for the southern route. Bulldog's lurking in the lane for now, and here comes Havost. Charging forward. Not finding anyone just yet.
Oh, if they approach Roshan Pit from the high ground, this is going to be disastrous.
Oh, no. Oh, no. This looks bad. They're going to start with the Lucid Beam. They find EGM. Can he get out of here in time? Tethers to the south. What a tether. Didn't tether back to the closest hero. Found one that was across a chasm.
That could have been so much worse for Alliance.
A lot of people would have just tethered like straight back like that, but this was definitely the smarter play.
And now Roshan is up. I think both teams know.
Well, Na'Vi should certainly check if they don't. They've got Forge Spirits right here. And they're going to walk up onto the high ground, perhaps? Nope. Funnick hiding out nearby. Roche starting to drop pretty quickly with a DD on S4. There ain't much time left. And Na'Vi, looks like they don't know. Or they're just going to give it up.
Funnick needs a trap inside the pit.
Yeah, very unusual not to see any traps in the pit. Alliance do not have a gem. They don't have sentries. Would have been able to spot this, but it's a free Roche for the Alliance. It will fall. It goes to Loda. Now a Sunstrike comes in, but it's far too late. And they're going to look to pick a fight here. Navi are actually going to pick a fight into the Aegis. This is very aggressive from them. And there's a completed AC on Loda. Here comes the meatball. Doing DC damage, but an RP connects on three. But Loda still falls. They bring him down. The Midas armor is too much, even with the Aegis. And EGM not able to assist him in that fight. Now Bulldog, he'll go down to one more club from that fist. And they force themselves forward. They jump on Loda. Havost chasing him back, driving him back. And now they're going to find a Wisp as well. Make it 3-0 and an Aegis down.
Was How that did a tactical not BKB by Havos there? I think so, actually.
I don't know. That's amazing how fast Loda dropped as well. I believe the Shadow Priest got Dazzle got his ultimate off on him. And they have the...
How I expected so that fight to go, he didn't dodge an unstable concoction. He clearly saw it coming. He didn't see it from fog, or he didn't cast it from fog. And then they just let Luna almost die, and then just completely turn the fight around with the heal, the Shallow Grave into the heal, into the Overgrowth, and then they control the fight from there. And it's not like S4 got a bad RP. He had a 3-man RP.
Yeah, he did, and I think one of the issues there is the Wisp got separated from... From Alchemist as well. Yeah, they weren't together, and he dropped a lot faster not having overcharge. So that seemed to hurt them quite a bit, but...
Yeah, and Loda without his Aegis, or when he responds with Aegis, doesn't have Chemical Rage. Real easy to bring down. He almost died a second time.
He has AC. Normally, this is where Alchemist and Vit Booster. Normally, very hard to kill, but with so much Midas Armor on Na'Vi, he just isn't tanky. Minus armor, it's always been one of Alk's weak points, similar to Doom, although with Doom you can make up for that a little bit easier.
So Alliance is in a really tough spot right now. They tried to take a 5-man fight, couldn't even take it with the Aegis. Oh, they're smoking up again.
Yeah, they're wrapping towards mid, but Havos, not the hero you want to go on. There's Living Armor backing you up, there's a Grave available as well, and he's got Manta BKB, and now they found Ake. Nowhere to snowball, really. He's just going to try and run. Another RP connects. This one also on three. And now Bulldog's here. It's five here. It's an ambush. But do they actually get enough kills in time? Avo's still alive. Standing strong. The Dazzle Heal doing its magic. And Alliance trade one for one after what looks like the perfect trap. On the backside goes Funnick. He gets one. He pays with his life. It is a 2-3 in the end.
That was a really good fight for them. And
they were fishing for a Sunstrike on Admiral Bulldog.
They just clumped too much.
Not going to find
S4. Him.
Yeah, that was an amazing trap by Alliance. It's like, oh, hey, it's a Tuskar. Let's go kill him. Suddenly RP. Suddenly every single hero comes swarming in.
So they do have a really good turtle lineup with the Magnus. And they have the Empower on the Alchemist to just make him Superman.
When RP's up. If RP's not up, Alliance are really going to struggle to defend the high ground. But now the BKB comes out. And so far, S4 has been 100% on point. But can't Na'Vi just farm this game?
Yeah, they definitely can. They can just get like a sheep on Dendi or just Necro Books like they typically like to do and just slow siege and wait for Alliance to come to them while spreading out, while making sure that they don't get hit by more than two people with RP.
And all their cores have some decent amount of farm at this point. The Luna and Invoker are the two leaders for sure, but even the TA getting good item progression. And I mean, these three heroes can all be very fearsome late-game DPSers, as well as having good lockdown.
Yeah, Luna, the only hero that hasn't died yet this game, already with a completed Mantis style. And looks like Na'Vi has the way better tower sieging lineup. And Alliance, they're kind of scrambling to find any sort of farm around the map now, too. Loda is ridiculously stacked. Looking at the net worth graph, he's still 1,500 net worth behind Havost, though.
Yeah. Havost is 2-0-8, and they have 12 kills, so he's not dying, and he's participating in almost everything. That's going to add up pretty quickly. And you mentioned this Alk probably needs a BKB, Ben. Well, he's going to go for one now, but I don't feel like it's a get-out-of-jail-free card. They can still bring him down just by giving him the old right-click.
Yeah, they do. Alliance doesn't have enough damage, though, aside from Alchemist. Na'Vi, they have damage from a lot of sources, from Luna, highest net worth in the game. Invoker, he can just follow up Overgrowth with a Meteor Blast. He actually has Meteor and Tornado invoked right now. Dazzle actually does a surprising amount of damage if Weave is allowed.
Oh, they're going to send five on bottom. They start with an RP. They relocate for this as well, and they outstun immediately. There will be no BKB. Havos will fall again. An Alliance strike. They desperately need these kills. But Invoker's farming, TA's farming, and they're going on mid now, and they're going to find EGM on the way back from the relocate, and they bring him down with ease.
Man, he just gets blown up. He needs more armor.
I guess he needs more farm as well. Like, good luck getting that armor with the way this game's developing.
I think you could potentially go for a medallion, I guess, for a cheap source of armor. Even a Vlad's or Basilius if he's that poor.
Yeah. We'll have to see if he... Even just a chainmail wouldn't be too bad. But we'll have to see if he can farm even that. And I mean, it still seems like Na'Vi have more ways to win this. I think they can almost take fights at this point, but they don't have to, and they can sit back and farm. Whereas it does seem Alliance's main way to take the game is winning big team fights. And if they let it turn into a farm war for too much longer, they're dealing with three farm carries, and they only are going to have one.
Mm-hmm. So let's see where S4 is going to move. He is pretty much the only playmaker for Alliance right now. Maybe they can find someone with the Shadow Blade, but Na'Vi hasn't really been put in too vulnerable out positions aside from Luna. But Luna has her HOD now. She can definitely stack Ancients and just get huge, get a Butterfly, or even get a Lincolns. There's no way to pop the Lincolns except for an Alchemist stun. So I think that would be really good for her.
And I guess a Walrus Punch, but...
I don't even know if it blocks it.
It's... Oh, actually, no, you're right. It doesn't.
Because it's a buff on...
Yeah, it's a buff on yourself.
So, yeah.
Yeah. Well, he is going Butterfly, by the way, so...
One of the supports could farm a Lincolns too, but I think once they do that, they can just slow siege and just let Luna stand by herself with everyone standing way far apart so they don't get clumped in with the RP and then just try and save her from there.
Loda continues to farm. Generally, it's a Basher at this point. It's got to come down to S4, right? I mean, that's...
It's really S4. If he doesn't hit a big RP...
It gives you flashbacks, doesn't it? This used to be how Alliance would win a lot of their games, was one big RP from S4 to rule them all. But hard to find those when Na'Vi aren't grouping. They're contentious to farm here.
Also, if Na'Vi can potentially counter gank, like if Dazzle is sitting somewhere where they think an RP is about to happen and they turn it around with an Eclipse, it's low chance, but it's better than losing map control because you're constantly afraid of relocate ganks.
Dendi just continues to push out the top lane, picks up an ultimate orb, and will work his way towards a Scythe of Ice. That's a big item for them and can really punish the Blink initiation if S4 ever forgets to BKB or if he just gets caught by a Na'Vi surprise attack. And the BKBs for now are very fresh, but as the game goes on, it'll become more and more relevant. Havos Butterfly nearly complete. Your TA probably going to build towards something like a Desolator for Funic and not too far off of it. Even more minus armor. Who could say no to that? But not there just yet.
Both teams with their eye on Roshan. Right now, you see
like
Bulldog constantly
checking
in.
30 seconds to go, I think?
Yeah. 15.
Not much time remaining. Alliance might be able to pull a fast one here, and it will be a Basher for Loda. BKB Basher, Abyssal Blade should come next, and just goes for the maximum single target lockdown man fight build.
His net worth is actually way ahead of Luna's right now. Oh, actually, only 1,000 ahead, but he was like 2,000 gold behind. Ancient stacking with Empower.
Grievous Greed, pretty good. But I don't know how far the gold's going to go, is my concern. I mean, even with Empowered, he's not always going to have it because of the BKB, and a lot of these Na'Vi heroes probably use the farm better in the ultra late game, like a Luna. You'd rather be 6-slot on Luna than Alka, I imagine.
Right.
And similar for, I mean, having TA Invoker, they use that farm really well, too.
It's the only way they're getting a decent advantage in the farm war, though. Without the Grievous Greed, they would fall really far behind due to how farm Havos is and how fast he farms.
And they are pretty far behind. 10k gold down, 10k experience down, but not overwhelmingly so. And Na'Vi are actually going double Butterfly here. And Loda's not going to really have room for an MKB unless he wants to sell this Vip Booster. He may be forced to, because if he doesn't have BKB or MKB, then they're going to be very hard to kill. And they will get the Roche. Alliance claim it again. This one's cheese. A nice pickup for them. But at this point, it's fair to ask the question, what are they going to do with it? Because just getting it doesn't seem like a guaranteed win.
It certainly does not. And Na'Vi, they have traps in good places. One at Roche, one at the Ancient Sack, but just not really able to do anything with it. Just because Troll is... Sorry, not Troll. Tree is such a passive hero.
Well, you say good places, but they just... the Roche just got melted and they did nothing about it.
At least they knew.
Yeah. At least they knew they were giving it up for free. Well, more items on the agenda for Na'Vi.
Or Smoke Gank.
But Alliance, yeah, they're the ones looking to force the tempo here. The relocate will come, and it'll suddenly be a big blob of four beefy melee heroes and a Wisp showing up for the party. Can they find that great opening for S4? Is there going to be a big RP? We all wait with bated breath as Favost lumbers right into Alliance the second that they move off the hill. How incredibly unfortunate. And now there's an RP. It's only on Funic, but they're going to bring him down. They relocate for this as well, and they do kill Funic once again. Snipe after snipe from Alliance.
Yeah, they're getting small kills, but the gold graph has just kind of stabilized, still around 10,000. Na'Vi not looking to take a big fight right now because Alliance still has the Aegis and the cheese.
And they'll have it for quite some time. The cheese actually went to S4. Maybe something he can look to pass to this Wisp, depending on how the fight develops. You can heal through the tether with that, but only if you're missing a lot of HP. So we'll see. Lota comes up high ground, and Denny immediately scatters. By the way, he has completed Scythe. We'll see a tornado. We'll see Lota jacking some Ancients. And it's back to the top lane to farm.
And they've warded it up, too. So Na'Vi won't be able to utilize that for 3 minutes.
Yeah, surprisingly, no gem on either team. No, Denny just picked one up, it looks like. It's still. Do you still favor Na'Vi here, the way the game's going?
Yes, with the Hex. I think they have the potential for pickoffs, which they didn't really have before. But if S4 just plays amazingly and has good RPs, it's going to be close. I would still say like pretty decent edge for Na'Vi. Their late game's just much better.
Like 70-30 Na'Vi?
Probably 75-25, even more than that.
That's rough. Well, rough. If you're a Swede, let's hope you're the 25% this game. Funic's going to come in, and they're going to find Ake here. Here's a Scythe. Here's a Meteor. Say hello to the Deafening Blast. And say goodbye to your Tusk. He's back to the Fountain. And Na'Vi may just continue marching out mid. Nope, they're back in. They want to defend. Funic's going to charge in, looking for Lota here. The Acid Spray gets deployed, and they'll back off to farm. Butterfly should be nearly done, I think. He's had this Eagle Horn for a while.
Yeah, he's had it for a pretty long time now.
Well, I guess he did die earlier, so. Slowing him down a bit, but Na'Vi just... I guess the gold lead's starting to dissipate a bit with, you know, a kill here, a kill there, giving up a few extra ones to Alliance. And what was once a 10k gold lead is now down to a 6k gold lead. And they're going to look to find another key kill here on Havost. Blink, there's your initiation from Bulldog. And now they go with S4 as well. They jump him, and they beat him up in the alley. And Havost is the next Na'Vi hero to drop. Alliance, the hits just keep on coming.
Yeah, he could have BKB TP'd if he had a TP, but they can't interrupt it with the Walrus Punch. So
and an RP.
Yeah.
Which they had
even need to use.
Yeah, they didn't even need to use. But they certainly can if they do.
So Na'Vi just splitting up and getting picked off right now. They can't really push either into RP. And... yeah, I mean, they're trying to outfarm them, but I don't really think that strat is working for them right now. The gold lead has dipped down to 5,000, and looks like Lota and the rest of Alliance will be actually the first people to pressure a T3.
Lota, he's picked up the Abyssal Blade, and he has a Boots of Travel buyback if he really needs it, although I doubt we're going to see it come to that. The armor gets dropped on the tower, but Lota just keeps on smacking away. In comes Funic as well. Not engaging just yet, but Lotus on the front lines and continues to clear the wave, and he does it quickly. Now he finds the Centaur. He will get stunned by the Centaur to start. Now a Scythe to follow. Or sorry. I'm seeing things. It's been a long day, but they'll back off now. They did good damage to this tower, though.
It doesn't matter, though. They have a tree.
Now your Ice Shards come out. Are they going to go in? Nope. And yeah, if they don't actually take towers, it really doesn't matter.
Yep, they're going to be backing off. Is it a fake back, though? They have vision now. This could be the time for them to go.
Give them the old loop-de-loop, perhaps?
Dendi has a gem.
Lotus going to get caught out here. He gets Scythe, and now focused by an Eclipse. Hobos hesitate for just a second there, but it's not nearly enough damage. Now BKB Eclipse are down. This is the time for Alliance to turn the fight if they can. The shard's slightly too short. There's no stun being channeled by Hobos. He just wants to get in range for an Abyssal Blade, but the Manta's going to come out, keeping him alive for the time being. And on the north side, your TA dukes it out with Aki. He gets punched right up in the air, but still at full HP. S4, haunting for an RP, has not found one yet. Dendi gets Grave. What a Grave from Kuroki. Bails him out, and now a 4 here. Overgrowth. Huge teamfight combination. Massive damage done here this day. And S4 on the run. Now Scythe. He'll make it 4. Alliance self-destructing, and Na'Vi in their home turf. Just running roughshod all over the Swedes.
That Grave, such well timed by Kuroki there.
Sick Grave, sick Overgrowth, and Dendi was ready with the AoE Wombo combo from the Invoker.
And this second buyback from Alchemist.
Killer Instinct engaged once again. The Alk buys back, but there's no RP for this fight. How much can they really do here? No Aegis available any longer. But they'll go for a Blink Skewer. This could turn it around a bit. Just kidding. There's a BKB, and the Glaives start a bouncing. Lotus losing the man fight because it's not a fair fight. It's not 1v1. In fact, there's backup here. They're bringing him low. Funnick is still diving. He's actually going towards the fountain. Now he's going to back off. And now Puppy caught out by Ake. Bulldog's falling on the sides of the fight. But the real focus should be on the Rax. That's what they're going to go for. Funnick in over his head will go down, but it's still a Rax most likely. Actually, Puppy falling as well. But Havost and Dendi, that Rax is almost dead. Sunstrike just off the mark. The Forge Spirits are going to bring it down. The huge victory here, taking the Rax, even for that many bodies, well worth the trade.
Yep, and the buyback on Alchemist too. So Alchemist is, yeah, he's fairly close to being 6-slotted. He has 3,500 gold even after that buyback. I don't know where Lotus farming all this gold, but even after that, Luna has more net worth.
Come from behind Dagon? I mean, there's a lot of other useful items he could have gotten. Shiva, Scythe.
I think he just wants to burst people down before they can get graved.
Can he burst down this Dazzle? Pretty tanky already. Ogre Club, Point Booster, and an Urn. 1470 HP.
Yeah, that's a lot of gold to invest in a Dagon.
Well, there's an RP bottom. They're going to relocate onto Dendi. He's completely focused, but the Grave's there again from Kuroki. He's been on point all day long. Now Dendi drops the Tornado, and he heads for the high ground. He heads for the hills. Can he get out of here? No. Blink from S4 ends his ambitions of living. And he drops a gem, so a nice pickoff from Alliance here.
Yeah, big picks by S4, though. They're utilizing the Relocate plus RP very, very well this game. It's pretty much the only thing that's kept them in this game.
It really is. It feels like the only thing keeping them in this game, those pickoffs. If they ever have to team fight, it just seems like they just don't have the damage.
A timely gank on Dendi, too, right before they take Roshan.
The Aegis and Cheese will fall into their lap, but what are they going to do with it? Last time, it didn't really help them that much. They still lost the Rax with it.
They could try and force a buyback from Dendi. That's what they should.
He'll be up in time, it looks like.
Well, the thing is, the tower's not even healed up. I don't really know what Puppy's been living armor, but it has not been this T3 tower. And
well, it's up now. Like, right now, he could be using it.
Yeah.
Should be using it.
Well, they have a good, 15-second window?
Oh, there you go. Right as we say that, he starts using it. Here comes Loda in the front lines. The Alk, not feeling as beefy as he used to, but still, he'll breach the base and he'll start to work on the tower. Clears it out, there's no glyph up yet. And with Overcharge, this is going to be a very fast tower kill, unless Na'Vi want to fight. Bulldog leaping in. They try and focus a boast. The Grave is there once again from Kuro. So timely with it. Now the BKB forced out from both carries. And they will retreat. Sunstrike comes in but does almost nothing. Well,
the Dagon wasn't enough there.
They didn't kill the tower. And it will continue to receive some assistance from the tree. I imagine. By the way, for this Dazzle, interesting build, he's gone Aghanims.
Aghs is really good on him. Well, it actually got buffed, too, I think.
Do you remember what the buff was exactly?
It used to be like 12, 18, 24 or something like that. 18, 24, 30. One of those two, I think, probably the former. 12, 18, 24, and then 30 seconds if you have your ult duration. But then they reworked it so that it lasts the same duration, but it just increases the amount of armor that you increase or decrease per level up of the skill. So pretty much it just makes it stronger and faster. Before it was stronger, but it just took longer.
Yeah, and these team fights are being decided in like 5-10 seconds. So
right. How much armor does it reduce by now?
It's 1 per second, is it? Yeah, 1 per second. 1.25 because he's got the eggs.
Yeah, 1.5 per second for 30 seconds, so 30 armor. Yeah. That's very significant, though, especially on a hero like Alchemist with low base armor.
Loda went heart against two butterflies, and they don't have a scythe. He's going to have a really hard time killing these heroes unless he gets
He's almost died in all these fights, though. Like, he's been really close to dying even during his BKB.
Yeah, but do they have the damage? I mean, the only way I see him killing these carries with... I don't feel like this Luna will die.
Well, technically, he doesn't have to focus the hero with the butterfly.
Yeah, he can cleave them.
Yeah, but that's really reliant on a big RP. I think if he loses the Aegis, he should definitely pick up a...
The one thing where... Sorry, pick up a...
He should definitely pick up MKB, like you said.
The one thing that they do have is that it works really nicely with Empower, which is based off of your base stats, so... It's a lot of damage.
Look how hard he's hitting right now. He's hitting for 550 damage.
DD Rune is going to help there, but yeah. He's pretty beefy, this guy. They'll look to siege, but this time the tower's at full HP. Healthier than it was last time. And Loda's going to do it again. He'll head on, but he gets scythed immediately. Pretty good. The scythe already down. That's something the Alliance will be very happy with. But Living Armor just keeps on bringing it back. Oy vey, this is so annoying for Alliance.
Look at their spread, too. They're, like, all positioned around. It's impossible to get a two-man RP at this point.
Yeah, Na'Vi are really spreading to the winds. And Alliance just keep on trying to force the fight. Middle lane pushes in, top lane pushes in. They're already down one lane of Rex. If they do lose a big fight, that could easily spell two or three falling. And looking at the buybacks, Luna, Alk, Invoker, Mag, two key heroes for both teams having it. None of the other heroes, though. Loda, Chemical Rage just cooled down. It's been a long push, and he'll go for it again. He'll head straight onto the high ground, but he eats a Dazzle. And let's see how low his armor gets here by the time it ends. It might go negative just from the Dazzle, actually.
Yeah, it'll go negative.
Yeah, and then that's not counting the Forge Spirits, the TA meld either. It would go like close to negative 20, I think, with both.
Yeah, TA no Desolator yet. But yeah, with the dual butterfly, they are fairly survivable because, I mean, they did go butterflies, so I guess the Dagon is really good versus that. Admiral Bulldog has Dagon 4 right now. I don't. When's the last time you've seen a Dagon on a Timber Soul?
When are we going to see that E-Blade? But hold that thought, because they've gone in now and they found Ake. He is going to instantly die, but they don't get Loda. He's the key prize. Still, a nice pickoff for Na'Vi.
They lose a gem, too, but no one, they don't know that it's there.
And they're getting excited here. Na'Vi fans feeling good, despite that 0-1 start from the Winner's Bracket Advantage already. It's 1-1, and looks like it might be headed their way with the Tri-Core really coming into full swing now. 50 minutes in. The TA is a bit under farm, but Havost is almost maxed. And they'll take down the Range Rex here. Nice, Manta. Dodging the stun, really well played. And Na'Vi will go for two lanes of Rex. They're going to commit to this push. Aegis down in 30 seconds. Maybe they should wait those 30 seconds. But I don't know if they will. Havost is feeling like nobody can kill him.
If S4 finds a good opportunity,
Dendi did manage to snipe the tower. And finding a good opportunity gets harder and harder now. Like you said, just a really good spread from
Na'Vi. Aegis is right about to expire. So this is a really bad time for Alchemist to run, and I think he knows.
And now the Aegis is down. Na'Vi have very little fear about forcing the issue. They breach the base again. He gets zapped, but they need to burst him down here. There's still a grave available for Kuro. He's just going to hang back. And S4 knows he can't go on him. Not like that.
Lotus getting kited a little bit. Looking at his BKB duration, it is only at 8 seconds, and he's had that BKB for quite some time. Hobo's getting healed up. He has a Satanic now, so he definitely has 2 lives if Kuroki doesn't get disabled.
He actually had that like in the last fight, but and like it was scary because they couldn't even take him below half. And then when they did, he just healed up instantly. It's where maybe if they get an E-Blade on Bulldog, that'll be enough to actually get the kill. But first, he's got to complete the Dagon 5, I imagine.
Avost is not getting any chip damage at all, which is usually what you can rely on with an Alchemist and a Timbersaw. Also, looks like Na'Vi is actually beating on the Range Rex too. So this thing is already at half HP, and Na'Vi, with the Aegis down, have this small window opportunity to do as much damage as possible.
And now it's Avost once more. He'll head to the high ground. S4's found him though, a beautiful Blake Skewer, but Avost gets off an Eclipse as well as popping his ultimate and does good damage. Now he focuses the Range Rex. S4 comes storming back in, grabs 2, but Puppy's there. He catches every single hero aside from EGM with a huge overgrowth. And now they've lost their mag. They have no RP. They have no Aegis. Dendi still stands, graved and kept alive. Bulldog will fall. He pops the cheese and lives. For now he lives. Havost is still fighting. Funnik is still fighting. They're diving. They're getting the kills. The Rex have fallen. Na'Vi are doing it. This will be 2 lanes of Rex. This will probably be game with S4 dead, with no RP. They're out of options. They're out of gas. And they're about to lose game 3 and be down 2-1. And in fact, they are. GG!
Well,
2-1.
2-1 indeed.
Are they going to do it again to Alliance and just come in with the 0-1 disadvantage and 3-0 them again?
They're well on their way to doing so. Alliance, I feel like their draft wasn't super strong again with the Tusk pick. The Tusk pick was like...
It seems very gimmicky. Like, you have to get those early kills in the lane, or it's...
And they definitely did not. Not with the Refraction, not with the Tree Armor. I actually felt like Puppy was a very huge factor on the Tree and Protector this game.
Yeah, that there was the one team fight near the bottom rune where Kuroki shallow grave Dendi from the high ground, like near the big camp. But Puppy was actually on top of the cliff to the right, and he got a 4-hero overgrowth off there.
Yeah, he had really nice positioning with that blink overgrowth to counter the blink skewer. And Alchemist, he had to pop his BKB earlier in the fight, so he's just going to stand there for like 3-5 seconds, just not doing anything.
And against the melee carry, like Alk, who already has trouble being kited in general, it's very easy to make sure you get the overgrowth off. Na'Vi's position was just sensational in those fights. Kuroki on the ball like, I don't know, 4-5 times with his graves. Puppy was always ready with a blink overgrowth. He did it 2 crucial team fights in a row.
Alliance good supports win games.
Alliance didn't play bad either. They had lots of pickoffs, but Na'Vi were just solid, and they had the lineup that was just going to have the edge in the late game.
They drafted greedier, and Alliance wasn't able to punish them for it. I think that Funnik didn't really have that much of an effect. I think his biggest impact was in the first 15 minutes, where the 2 supports were forced to mess with him instead of getting the levels that they needed and playing greedy like the Na'Vi supports.
They invested a lot. The tri-lane gank failed initially bottom, then they couldn't kill up top with living armor. I mean, it was a big investment, and it didn't pay off.
Mm-hmm.
Funnik didn't actually have that much impact in terms of, you know, winning the fights, but just was hard to kill and, you know, provided some damage, helped them to contest Rosh a few times.
He created space. The biggest thing was that he created pressure. It's like the other team's like, okay, we have to zone out this offlane TA. We have to...
You can't let a TA farm and get levels in the offlane, like, right. as a carry. That's like letting, like, I don't know, a Morphling do that or something.
So is this a draft win, or is this a outskill win, outplay win?
I think Alliance just had the more difficult and kind of one-dimensional draft to execute. Very reliant on a few specific things. RP, snowballing in the laning stage with the Tuskar tri-lane. And failing to do that, they were always going to have an uphill battle.
Mm-hmm.
Not an outdraft, but I think Na'Vi had the more well-rounded draft.
So, yeah, it doesn't seem like Alliance has been able to outdraft Na'Vi in either of these games. And I think the early bans are, you can't ban everything that Na'Vi is really good
at. Like you said, they just have so many weapons.
Right, like TA and Dazzle and Trudy. Like, you don't see any of those heroes very often at all.
It's like, where was this Na'Vi on day 1? You know?
Yeah, really.
They've got like a billion strategies, but they, you know. They weren't using them then.
Only when they're on the brink of elimination.
They want to make it interesting, and they want to give us 4 as many matches as possible here. Well, they've certainly delivered on that promise.
Well, guys, that means they have to lose the next game.
Yeah. And now they have Alliance where they right where they want them, which is on the ropes. Alliance has to win two in a row. I wouldn't count either team out, though. It could really go either way. Who do you think is going to win? Navi 3-1?
It seems that way. It just seems like Alliance can't get that early game lead, and Navi's able to really, really punish them for it. Yeah. Like, Fnatic got an early game lead, and they weren't able to punish them for falling behind, but Navi just completely decimated them.
Yeah, I think the funny thing is, it's like kind of ironic, right? Because Alliance used to be the team that would always outgreed their opponents, and they're losing to more greed. It's tough to deal with. Well, guys, with that being said, that puts Game 3 into the books. Navi now leading 2-1. This could be yet another Star Ladder win for them. If they do it twice in a row to Alliance, at that point you have to say maybe Navi just flat out have the edge on them in terms of the head-to-head matchup. And it's starting to feel that way even before this event.
Not at TI3, though.
Not at the one event where it really mattered the most. Well, they had them on the ropes in Game 5, but that's ancient history at this point, guys. We'll take a quick break. I'm LD. He's Merlini. We're here from Beyond the Summit, casting on behalf of Star Ladder, and we'll be back with Game 4, potentially our final game, after this short commercial break. When